Hi, and welcome to the Six Office Hours.
Welcome.
It's going to be our last office hours, and it's been a ton of fun TAing this class. I'd first like to thank the students and Professor Norvig, you too. This has been a great experience.
Great. What do we got for questions this week?
All right. First question comes from Horace He, and he says, what steps should I take after finishing this class to keep improving as a programmer?
That's a great question. There's so much to do. Of course, there are other classes available, and so you can search online. You can see what classes are coming up next, figure out what you're interested in, and just have at it. And then the other thing is to do more programming on your own. So pick out a project and try to achieve it, try to complete something. And that can either be find some open source project where you can contribute, or just something of your own, something that you always wanted to do. Just get started and try to build it.
And for small problems, Project Euler has a lot of really great problems. You can check that out online.
Mm-hmm.
Next one comes from Lee Ma. And so after teaching this class, you've been very active in the forums, and you've seen a lot of the common mistakes students have made. So what can you say about some of the common mistakes that have been made throughout this class, and any general suggestions on being a good programmer?
I didn't see that many things that were common across everywhere. Let's see, I guess a couple of them, some around the structure of mutable variables seems to come up again and again. So, you know, I made this array and then I altered the first element of the array, but all the elements got altered. Why did that happen? Well, it's because each row of your matrix was actually the same row. So that seemed to be a problem. There was one today of the default arguments to functions. They're set up and that's a single argument. So if you modify it, then you have a problem with that. So that was one thing. I guess another one is just reading the documentation and getting familiar with things. And I don't see that so much as an error on the part of the students. I just see it as not having enough familiarity. And it just takes time to get familiar with things. And I guess another is just read carefully, and that I see people ask a question and then see the answer and then say, so I realized the mistake I made or the misconception I had. And sometimes that's just part of the learning process, but maybe you could use that as a lesson to yourself of saying, I'm stuck. It must be because, or it could be because there's some preconception that I have that is blocking me. And so think of, what preconceptions am I holding, and should I relax one of those?
Okay. Next question comes from Ginger Cullen, and she wants to know what areas of software you are particularly excited about.
I think it's an exciting time now when there's so much going on. And so many opportunities, new companies springing up, new ideas in software. I guess to me, one of the things that's really interesting is connecting with the world in a deeper way. That we're used to the idea of data like text and numbers can be processed by computers. But now we're starting to see images and video and sound, and people are walking around with phones that have input devices for all of these constantly with them. And so this connection to the real world is so much stronger, and that just opens up so many new areas.
Okay, next question comes from Igoots, and Igoots wants to know if you have any tips for reading other people's code and writing your own code so it's more readable by others.
Okay, in terms of reading other people's code, a lot of it is practice, so just go out there and start doing it. I always like to play with code when I'm reading it. I find it hard and frustrating to read code without an interpreter or a compiler available so that I can actually run it and try it and see what it does. And theoretically, you should be able to write code, so you don't have to do that, but it's just so much easier if you can to say, I really want an example here of what does this function do? And the person who wrote the code didn't document it, didn't give me an example. Okay, I can run it myself and see what it produces. So I think of reading as more of an interactive process rather than a passive one, the way you read a novel, and don't be afraid to do that. I think another aspect is how are you reading it? And when you read a novel, you pretty much start at the front, you go to the end. But when you read code, you don't do it like that. And you have to figure out what you're reading for. Are you trying to understand the whole code, in which case you're still jumping around and you're figuring out, well, what's the big idea? What are the key components? Let's flip back and forth. Let's follow this cross-reference. It's another reason why I don't like reading statically. I want to be able to jump to the definition of a symbol, and my IDE does that for me. So you're jumping around. And then another way of reading is to say, okay, here's a big complicated package, but I just want it to do this one thing. And so I'm going to restrict myself from trying to understand everything. I just want to understand one path through so I can get at this function call or this functionality and have it do what I want to do. I find that hard for me. And I guess one of the things I see is sort of maybe a generation gap in that the younger engineers I work with are so much better at that than I am, that they can look at a piece of code and say, I just want to get this one functionality. They figure it out, they use it, and they're on to the next thing. Whereas I usually lag behind. I say, okay, you know, I think I got this functionality, but gee, this is interesting. Let me look around a little bit more, see if I can understand the structure more deeply. So I'm learning more from that, but I'm diverting myself from what my task really was, to just find out as much as I needed to know and not more. So that's something I know I need to train myself on, of doing a better job of reading selectively.
All right, the last two questions both come from Jeff Blom, and his first question, where do you get your wonderful shirts?
Okay, Jeff. One answer is not available to you in that my wife makes some of them, and she's not going into the business of mass producing them, so that you won't be able to get one. This one, I think, is made by a company called Jams World, but, you know, I get them wherever I can.
All right. And the last one, a little more content-driven, is why did you structure so much of this course around games? What made you decide that?
Yeah. I guess the reason I chose games is I wanted you to get experience of understanding a set of rules and following them. And games are sort of an abstraction of that, right? And we wanted to have a 7-week class. It's not that long. We want to be able to go through a lot of examples. And sort of more real-world problems are just so complicated and messy. And I think that's one reason games exist in the first place, right? So they say, like, the game of chess is supposed to be an abstraction of war. And it's much easier to set up a chessboard than it is to muster up a couple of armies and go through the messy business of destroying each other. So games are an abstraction, but they're still complicated. They have interactions, they have rules that you have to get right. And so they seemed just at the right level for a short class like this, as opposed to a more real-world problem where we'd have to spend the whole 7 weeks just to understand one of them.
Great. That's all the questions we had.
There was one. How about this one on recursion?
Oh, sorry, I missed that one. Good.
Yeah.
So yeah, there was a question on recursion. I think this was from Egoots as well. And basically, he's having a hard time implementing recursion in his daily coding routine. He finds that it's easier to just use loops. And do you use recursion in your everyday coding?
Yeah. So I guess there's a couple answers to that. One is I think you should use it when it's appropriate and not when it's not. Now, there are some approaches and, you know, there are even some simple languages where recursion is your only way of implementing loops. I don't prefer that approach. I think you want to do what's most natural. And so when is recursion natural? I think there's a couple cases. One is when you have a recursive data structure. So if you have a tree is defined as it's either a node or it's a node that has two trees or n trees as subparts. And so there's recursion built right into the definition, and it just makes sense to implement the whole thing recursively. And so most of the time when you have a structure like a tree that's like that, it's simpler to do a recursive routine. Now sometimes you don't, so we showed some search techniques where instead of just searching recursively, we built up a queue, like the frontier queue, to essentially hold the equivalent of what would be on the recursive stack. Why do we do that? Because we wanted more control over the order of the recursion. We didn't want to just do left branch first or right branch first. We want to be able to pick where we went next. And so to make control, we made the program more complicated. So anytime you take a naturally recursive data structure and process it non-recursively, it becomes more complicated. I think the opposite is also true. If you take a non-recursive thing, like iterating over the elements of a list in a for loop, you know, for x in list, that's much simpler as a for loop. It becomes more complicated if you write it recursively. And so there, I would prefer having for loops. There's another case that's sort of intermediate where you have a mathematical formula. More often, mathematical formulas are written recursively. And then you have to decide, is it best to implement that with recursion or with a loop? And so that's how I see it. The other question was, are there limitations in terms of the implementation? And yes, that's true. In many languages, there's a recursion limit. In some languages, specific types of calls in a location in the function where the last thing that the function does doesn't get counted against the call limit. In Python, they do get counted, so you have a limit. I think by default in the CPython implementation, it's 1,000 levels deep. And so you have to think about that. You know, so even if it is more natural to do recursion, if you say, well, I'm going to be doing it over structures that are more than 1,000 elements deep, then you have to accommodate. And I guess that's another reason to say why you know, recursing down a list is probably a bad idea, because you, in many applications, you do have lists that are more than 1,000 elements deep. But recursing over a tree is probably OK, because if you have, say, a balanced binary tree, you would only hit the limit if it has 2 to the 1,000th elements, and you'd run out of memory before you hit that problem.
All right. Well, I think that's all the questions. And again, it's been a lot of fun. Any last words for the students?
Yeah, thank you so much. And good luck on the rest of week 6 and on the exam. I think you'll find it interesting and challenging, and a good conclusion to the class. So thank you all.